Silver Dollar City is a theme park located in Branson, Missouri. A family park owned by the Hirschend Entertainment Company that is known for being one of the best theme parks in the nation. It is home to multiple world-class roller coasters and attractions and has some of the best food and entertainment in any park. One of its first ever attractions was Buzzsaw Falls, a prototype water coaster from a fairly unknown manufacturer known as Premier Rides. However, it wouldn't last long. What once was a family water coaster to soak guests on the hot summer days is now a powerful launch coaster with a strange and unique layout. So why did it close? Let's dive in as we learn the story behind Buzzsaw Falls. When it comes to roller coaster manufacturers, we all have our favorites. Bolliger & Mabillard, Intamin, and Rocky Mountain Construction continue to dominate the modern roller coaster industry. But there was a golden age for these manufacturers. Throughout the 1990s, we saw some new and familiar faces create some of the best rides. At the time, some of the best were Custom Coasters International, B&M, and even Aerodynamics. However, we would also see a new manufacturer join the modern coaster wars in the mid-90s. In 1994, Premier Rides, a new roller coaster manufacturer, was founded. Located in Baltimore, Maryland, this manufacturer would specialize in launched roller coasters. In fact, the company has only made one coaster that has a lift hill. Around the 90s, the only type of launch coaster we saw were catapult launch coasters and flywheels, as seen on either Schwarzkopf or Aero shuttle loop coasters. We would also see friction wheels to launch the trains as seen on the Bullet that now operates at Selva Magica in Mexico. In 1995, Disneyland Paris, working with Vekoma, would create the first ever full-circuit launch coaster using a catapult launch system called Space Mountain from the Earth to the Moon. This coaster was revolutionary to the amusement industry, as many other manufacturers would later try their best on creating a full-circuit launched roller coaster. One of the first manufacturers to ever make one was Premier Rides. In 1996, Premier would open their first two roller coasters as they partnered with Paramount Parks to open Outer Limits Flight of Fear, the first ever LIM-launched roller coaster. LIM is short for Linear Induction Motors. This is a form of an electromagnetic propulsion system containing no moving parts. Typically, LIM systems can launch the roller coaster train from the station really fast. When Flight of Fear first opened, guests could not believe how powerful the launch was. Now, in today's world, it may not be as special as some of the other launching mechanisms we have, like a hydraulic launch or an air launch, but this system was ahead of its time. Premier Rides would continue to build coasters across the country, like Runaway Mountain at Six Flags Over Texas, the only coaster they would build with a lift hill, and they would later build one of the best and most sorely missed defunct coasters, Batman and Robin the Chiller, at Six Flags Great Adventure. One of their first roller coasters they made that still operates to this day is Mr. Freeze Reverse Blast at Six Flags Over Texas and Six Flags St. Louis. These two roller coasters are known for being one of the best in the world due to its extreme forces and mesmerizing spike. 4 years into development, and they've already made 7 roller coasters. Some could even say that they were the RMC in the 90s. But all we have seen from this manufacturer were LIM launched coasters. It was time they did something new that nobody saw coming. Silver Dollar City in Branson, Missouri started as a touring site for the famous Marble Cave. This would be one of the first attractions to open in Branson, and some say that this cave alone is what makes Branson one of the biggest tourist destinations in the country. The cave tour dates back all the way to the 1880s and would continue all the way to the 1960s until the site was bought by the Hirschend Entertainment Company. While little was spent on advertising, publicist Don Richardson's idea of giving silver dollars as change to park visitors led to tremendous word-of-mouth exposure of the site. When tourists were returning home, when they would pay for their gas and other purchases with silver dollars, people would ask where they got the coins, and the tourists would describe the park as their Silver Dollar City adventure. I mean, when you think about it, this is a very smart way of advertising.
Aunt Judy, how did Silver Dollar City get its name?
Well, Annie, honey, back when them shopkeepers, they would give people change in silver dollars, like that and there. All folks would get home and they'd pull change out of their pockets and somebody would holler, "Woo, where'd you get them silver dollars?" And they'd say, "Silver Dollar City."
The park would continue to grow, and throughout the next 20 years, they would buy many attractions and place them throughout the village, turning them into a theme park. In 1993, the park would add their first roller coaster known as Thunderation, a mine train coaster manufactured by Aerodynamics, which still operates to this day. Thunderation is very unique, as instead of going up a lift hill and going down a traditional mine train layout, Thunderation would be built on the side of a mountain and would immediately dispatch out of the station into a large coaster section. Following the success of Thunderation, it was time for the park to invest into another large attraction. In 1998, SeaWorld Orlando would work with Mock Rides to build the first ever water coaster known as Journey to Atlantis. This ride would combine a traditional water ride with a roller coaster. It would not only feature a large drop, but it would also feature a roller coaster section with twists and turns. However, Premier Rides would also be working on their very own type of water coaster, known as the Liquid Coaster. As they were developing the prototype, Silver Dollar City was interested in this product and began working with Premier to develop the first ever liquid coaster.
Although Silver Dollar City has the look and feel of the 1890s, they also have the latest in roller coaster technology. It's what the industry calls thrill convergence. Buzzsaw Falls is an example. It's part boat, part coaster.
This is the type of ride, the way it's designed is it's multiple elements. We use that concept of thrill convergence, we call it, where you're taking multiple ride elements. You've got a free-floating rapids ride experience, you've got a coaster experience, you've got a stunning lift, a very steep one that gives you a view that you can see for miles and miles. You can look out at the Branson Bell. And then you've got that exciting, thrilling, steep drop down into the water, 6.5 stories. So multiple elements. So everyone's going to find something that they're going to really enjoy on this ride.
On July 3rd, 1999, Buzzsaw Falls would open to the public. The ride was originally supposed to open in April, but was pushed back due to small technical difficulties. When the ride opened, it was a hit with the public as it allowed guests to experience a thrill, but also to cool down on those hot summer days. The layout went as follows. The ride would dispatch out of the station into a small log flume-like section as it would float around a themed sawmill. The ride would then connect to the coaster track, go through the sawmill, and begin its roller coaster section. The ride would leave the sawmill and go down a small drop. Following this, you would then go down two small drops and go through a large turnaround to the right as you would reach a top speed of 50 miles per hour. After this, the ride would slow down and head up the large 110-foot lift hill. After this, the coaster would take a slow turn to the left and go down a large 65-foot drop. The reason why the drop is shorter than the lift hill is because this ride was built on a mountainside. The ride would then slowly traverse back to the station. While Buzzsaw Falls may seem like a simple ride, it was a technical nightmare. The ride used a different kind of sensor than the traditional proximity sensors as seen on numerous other roller coasters. Buzzsaw Falls would use infrared sensors, which were glitching countless times, which caused the ride to either e-stop or face other problems. The ride would also have countless computer errors because of these sensors. Another problem was the ride would be consistently pumping thousands of gallons of water, which as you can imagine is quite expensive. Another issue is that the ride vehicles could easily begin to flood if too much water was inside the vehicle, so plastic shields were added on all sides to prevent flooding. Buzzsaw Falls cost $7 million to build. Now with the constant computer errors and pumping thousands of gallons of water at a time, Silver Dollar City had to consistently invest large amounts of money into this attraction during its operation. Now by no means was Buzzsaw Falls a rough or boring attraction. In fact, guests adored this ride. However, it wouldn't be long till we saw the downfall of a fan favorite. Buzzsaw Falls would continue to operate throughout 1999, 2000, 2001, and 2002. However, in 2003, we would finally see the downfall of Buzzsaw Falls. Throughout its 4 years of operation, while it was an enjoyable ride, it was costing the park more money to maintain the coaster than the average guest that paid to ride Buzzsaw Falls. We usually see this happen to older roller coasters that have operated for years, like Dueling Dragons and Vortex. However, Buzzsaw Falls would close permanently in 2003, and would be renovated into something that was never seen before. In 2004, Silver Dollar City began demolishing sections of Buzzsaw Falls. However, they would keep a few sections of track. Why? Well, throughout this time, the park would work with S&S to build a whole new roller coaster known as Powder Keg. In 2005, this new launch coaster would open to the public. The ride would reuse the original station of Buzzsaw Falls and would use an upwards transfer track to send the ride to the launch section. The ride would then launch up into a top hat. Following this, the ride would then turn into a large airtime hill, which would then be followed by an overbank turn. After this, the ride would then go into a Stangle dive and would turn and transition into the Buzzsaw Falls turnaround. They would not retrack this section. They would literally keep the Buzzsaw Falls turnaround and connect it to a fast, thrilling, launched roller coaster. Yeah, it makes sense. After this, the ride would go up the exact same lift hill that Buzzsaw Falls went through and would go through the same finale that Buzzsaw Falls also went through. However, it would go through a snappy helix after the drop. While Powder Keg as a ride makes no sense, it is a fan favorite at Silver Dollar City that still operates to this day. Now, the coaster would pay homage to Buzzsaw Falls, as you can see a crashed and mangled Buzzsaw Falls car stuck inside the roof of the station. While Powder Keg is known as one of S&S's greatest roller coasters, you must remember the unique water coaster that once stood in its place. Thank you guys for watching, and I hope you enjoyed this episode of The Story Behind. If you have any roller coaster or attraction that you're interested in learning more about, leave a comment down below and who knows, it might just be my next episode. If you enjoyed The Story Behind, make sure to check out this playlist with every single episode of this series. As always, this was Hunter from Theme Park Hunting. I'll see you guys later, and follow the thrill.